Welcome to the next episode of Great War Story. I've got a good one for you today. It's the story of Tahu Rhodes, who was ADC or aide de camp to General Godley. So if you don't know what an aide de camp is, it's basically like the gopher for a general. A young officer will be attached to a general and will, help them with all their day-to-day administrative stuff, that kind of thing. This kind of tradition has been around for a long time. In the Roman Republic, they call them contubernali, literally a tent mate, which came from the idea of Roman, small squads that would hang around, go together, each one carrying a segment of the tent and literally sleep in a tent together. But it was also metaphorically used to mean an ADC to a Roman general, young Roman aristocrats up and coming. Famous people like Marius, for example, was a contubernalis for the general Scipio Aemilianus, if you know anything of Roman history. But anyway, let's get on with the story of Tahu Rhodes. Originally, I was going to be about something completely different and just a bit of background about who Tahu was. And then I found more and more things to say about Tahu, so I ended up having to split it into two separate episodes, but they're both standalone. And this one exploded to be probably a bit big anyway, but I think you'll enjoy it if you've liked my other videos. So let's get into it. So his full name was actually Arthur Tahu Grover Rhodes. Note, did I say Grover? I meant Gravenor. And he came from the New Zealand elite, or New Zealand aristocracy, if New Zealand had such a thing. His father was mayor of Christchurch at one point. He was also a member of parliament for the area of Geraldine. And I assume that this name Gravenor must come from some aristocratic title. Well, it would, because it literally came across with the Normans. It's a very old name. But how it ends up as the middle name of so many of these members of the family, I couldn't work out. I traced it back to the father of, the grandfather, and it was still there. And I don't know. I couldn't actually work it out in the end. So Arthur Tahu Gravenor Rhodes, but everybody calls him Tahu, was born in 1893, which was actually the same year as my grandfather. But he died in 1947, so he died relatively young. And this on the right is not him, that's his father. Moving on. Now, I borrowed this photo from, you can see, well, I gave proper attribution at the top, Daryl's Gallipoli Diary on WordPress.com. And we have senior officers of the New Zealand Expeditionary Force, and which was taken just before they left New Zealand in 1914. And the ones I've circled are ones who have come up in some of my previous episodes. There's General Russell, there's Major General Chater. He was actually the court-martial judge for Private Andrus, if you've watched that episode. General Godley, of course, was the general in command of the whole thing, the New Zealand Expeditionary Force. Over on the right, there's Essen. I quoted him just the other day in Mrs. Goodchild, where he was talking about some of the hospitals in Egypt. And Malone, I've quoted his diary in some previous episodes. And you see there in the second row, right behind General Godley, is this young man. He would only have been 20, I think, at the time of this photo. So a very young man, but rubbing shoulders with the very top ranks of the New Zealand officer corps. Oh, yeah, and as I was reading his diary, he talked about Brathwaite, and he said, or Old Grumpy, as we call them. So I couldn't help putting that little detail in there that apparently Brathwaite's nickname was Old Grumpy as far as the younger officers were concerned. Tahu Rhodes never quite explained why, but I thought that was a great name. Now, I'm going to quote from Tahu Rhodes' diary quite a lot. Now, it was very long, all typed up, so it contains a lot of content. So I'm not trying to be comprehensive. Frankly, I read the whole thing, and I just picked out things that appealed to me or were interesting for one reason or another. So I'm not trying to tell a history of the New Zealand Expeditionary Force for the whole time Tahu Rhodes was there. I'm just picking out certain episodes And well, the first one I found that particularly interesting was Wednesday, 26th of October. This is when they're on the fleet. They left New Zealand on October the 16th, and they stopped in Tasmania, and their second stop was in King George's Sound in Western Australia. And here's what he had to say. Steaming up the King George Sound was, I think, the most impressive and finest sight I've ever seen. We steamed slowly through the lines of the 27 Australian transports. Each one saluted and cheered us as we passed. The Australian ships look very shabby after ours. None of them are painted grey, and we call them the Rainbow Fleet. I'm afraid in future we'll have to go much slower, as their slowest ship can only do 10.5 under the most favourable conditions. We averaged 11.6 knots one day coming from Hobart. So you can see already there's a bit of trans-Tasman rivalry between New Zealand and Australia coming out. And this was where the combined fleets massed. All the Australian transports were told to go to King George Sound, and the New Zealand main body fleet arrived at King George Sound, and the combined fleet would then head up across the Indian Ocean, heading towards, well, first Sri Lanka and ultimately Egypt. And this is a painting, in fact, of the massed fleet gathering at King George Sound from the Australian War Memorial. Now, next entry I chose to highlight. Well, it's actually from the same day. At 4 p.m., one of the Minotaur's picket boats came for us, and we went off to the Orvieto and called on General Bridges. Now, the Orvieto was the Australian flag transport. So the Maunganui that was carrying General Godley, who was carrying Tahu Rhodes, it was also carrying my grandfather, although he was just a driver with the New Zealand Mounted Field Ambulance. They just happened to be on the same ship. They would call the Maunganui the flag transport for the New Zealand troop ships. In other words, the transport ship carrying the general. The Orvieto was the flag transport for the Australian Imperial Force and was carrying its general, General Bridges. The Australian seemed to live like fighting cocks on the fat of the land. As a passenger ship, she carried over 12,000 passengers. The HQ staff, aide, have the whole first saloon to themselves. In other words, they're living the life of luxury. They're giving being far too many goodies, far too soft conditions as far as Rhodes is concerned. They allow drink and cigarettes. Each man gets one pint of beer a day. The men look very untidy and slovenly after hours, and I'm more convinced than ever that we are far superior to them in every way. And there's a couple of troopers, in fact, in Egypt much later, with cigarettes and beer. True disclosure, I have to tell you that those soldiers are actually New Zealanders, but I thought it was appropriate given the comment that Tahu Rhodes was making. And I think in the previous episode, I explained how one of the nicknames the troops gave the New Zealand Expeditionary Force was General Godley's Sunday School Picnic because he banned cigarettes and booze on the ships while the Australians were allowed them. The part of the call I enjoyed most was a whiskey and soda and several cigarettes. So even though Rhodes is kind of looking down at them, oh, they're allowed booze and smokes and things like this, but I did rather enjoy having some booze and smokes while I was aboard the Orvieto. And just by way of something very curious, when I was visiting my mother, she took me to a cafe on in just south central Auckland, and we were sitting down and having our enjoying our coffee, and I happened to notice that the cafe was called the Orvieto. I wonder about how that cafe got its name, but I really don't know the answer. Now, I've mentioned a number of times this trans-Tasman rivalry. There's the Australian kangaroo with the Australian flag. Notice I pointed out last episode the white star, pure white stars tell you it's the Australian flag, and on the right, the stars which are red with a white outline tell you it's the New Zealand flag. And well, I just found this picture on the internet somewhere to represent the trans-Tasman rivalry, but I liked it. And we're not done with it yet. There's the fleet sailing out across the Indian Ocean. That date that's down there on the bottom right, it says 1941, it's 1914. Somebody made a mistake there. November the 2nd. Australians hopelessly bad, and last night were all over the place. The Hororata looks a very fine ship, but she's very bad as far as station keeping is concerned. That's the Hororata on the right, Actually, in the far distance, putting up all that smoke, that's the a heavy Japanese cruiser, the Ibuki, that was also helping escort them. Captain Kittle of HMS Minotaur, that's the flagship, not the flag transport, but actually the British flagship that's leading the whole thing. Captain Kittle of HMS Minotaur sent a signal congratulating the New Zealand division on their regard to orders, relights, and station keeping, and he added that he could not say the same about the Australians. We are all, of course, delighted. November the 7th. Australians still very bad at station keeping and always make a point of showing all possible lights. Captain Kittle sent them a long message today, taking them off properly and holding us up as a good example. We are all so bucked with ourselves, we don't know what to do. So, yes. So he says, okay, you Australians, you slackers, you're not maintaining your proper positions. It makes it very hard for us to give you escorts and proper security, and we could see lights showing at night. This makes it easy for an enemy to find you. Just do a better job, please. And message to the New Zealanders. Well done. Keep it up. Splendid. Ha. And then later, what as they approach the Cocos Islands, about three quarters of the way to Sri Lanka, a most exciting day. At 7 a.m., a message came from the Arawa to say she had intercepted a wireless message from the Cocos saying, "Strange warship in sight. SOS, SOS," which is a distress signal. It's interesting that Tahu Rhodes feels necessary to explain what SOS means. I guess with wireless being so new, the term SOS hadn't entered common usage so that he felt he needed to explain it. So anyway, strange warship in sight. SOS, SOS. This message was then jammed by a high power message in Dutch or possibly code. We forwarded the whole message on to the Melbourne, who at once ordered the Sydney off to the Cocos Islands, which were only about 35 miles away. At 9 a.m., we could hear the Sydney trying to call up the Melbourne, but there was a high power station somewhere jamming them. At 9:30, we intercepted a message from the Sydney saying that she was engaging with the enemy. As this naval battle was only about 40 miles away on our left flank, it was most exciting. And the ship at the bottom is the Arawa. She was one of the New Zealand troop ships. And this actually gives a crucial detail that's often missing from a lot of the accounts of the battle between HMAS Sydney and the German cruiser, the Emden, which was the fact that only one ship with its Marconi room was able to pick up the SOS signal because the Emden was madly jamming it. And that was the New Zealand transport, the Arawa. Now, a few other details to explain here. Why the Melbourne, the Australian cruiser HMAS Melbourne? Well, because at this point, the Minotaur had actually left the fleet. She had got other orders. And when she left, she passed the flag to the Melbourne. So the Melbourne was now the flagship. Otherwise, she would have been second most senior. If the Minotaur had still been there, it would have been the Melbourne who had been sent to check out what was going on with the SOS distress call. Since Melbourne was now senior, she had to pass it on to the next one, which was the Sydney. The Ibuki wanted to head off as well, but just in case it was a trap to lure the escorts away, the Melbourne ordered the Ibuki to come back. The Ibuki, the Japanese, weren't very happy about this, but it was the right call, and they did obey orders. And well, maybe another time I may make an episode about the whole battle between the Sydney and the Emden, but not today. If you are interested in it, in the meantime, there's plenty of episodes on YouTube by other people about it, or you could check out this book, First Victory, 1914, HMSA Sydney's Hunt for the German Raider Emden. You could do worse than read it. Now, moving on, November the 15th, 1914. Church parade at 7:30 a.m. It's one of the things that comes through clearly with these World War I accounts. There's always a church service on a Sunday, and it seems like everybody goes to them. That's perhaps a little bit different from how the military does things today, I guess. So, church parade at 7:30 a.m. We sighted land at 8 a.m. and arrived at Colombo 9:30. We anchored inside the breakwater. At 10 a.m., the Sydney, with the armed merchantman Empress of Asia, he actually got that wrong. It was actually the Empress of Russia, but never mind. The armed merchantman Empress of Russia, a CPR liner of 17,500 tons and 21 knots, arrived. The latter ship had the prisoners on board, and the Sydney had most of the wounded. And At the top right, that is the Sydney, and on the bottom right, that is the Empress of Russia. She was what they called an armed merchantman. They'd kitted her out with some guns on her deck so that she was able to, fight effectively, not as good as a genuine warship, but she had teeth. General Malcolm, General Officer Commanding Ceylon, a funny old Scotchman and a most incompetent looking man, called at 10:30 a.m. And then some of the officers off the Maunganui and Lady Godley went to do some shopping in Ceylon, and they brought, amongst other things, 7 dozen bottles of lime juice with the £5 Nanny gave Lady G before we started. Well, I thought that was kind of curious. I guess they felt that lime juice was a good ingredient, probably for keeping you healthy and avoiding scurvy and things like that, I guess. And perhaps it was particularly cheap. I don't know. 7 dozen bottles of lime juice does seem like rather a lot, though. And then there were these rather wonderful photos I found. This shows the Sydney steaming into port. You can see the breakwater that they were anchored behind. And this is the Sydney arriving, and her decks were, you can't see it in the photo, but by all the accounts, her decks were crammed with wounded Germans who were being brought in. And in fact, the troop ships were all told no cheering because they wanted to show respect for the all the wounded Germans, and they felt that if they cheered the Sydney, it would feel like they were jeering or putting down the poor Germans who had fought valiantly. So everybody was told no cheering. Except the message didn't get through to one single Australian troop ship, so they were all cheering, going, "Yay!" So not quite perfect, but almost. And on the bottom, you can see there are two photos of the Emden. One is actually taken from on board the wreck. You can see it was really badly smashed up in the battle. She'd beached herself on this island to avoid sinking, and you can see, well, there's a longer shot that gives you a better sense of what you're looking at. And this one from the National Army Museum showed some New Zealanders taking the mail that all the troops had written to be delivered to the post office in Ceylon to be sent back to New Zealand. And it made me think of the shopping trip. You know, maybe all those bottles of lime juice were brought back in a wagon pulled by a water buffalo, just like this one. Who knows? Now, I couldn't help but be fascinated by that description of General Malcolm as an incompetent looking man. So I wanted to find out, well, what does he look like? Well, there he is. Does he look incompetent to you? I don't know. Apparently, whatever the reason he left that a bad impression on Tahu Rhodes, his full name was Henry Huntley Leith Malcolm. And was he incompetent? I don't know. I didn't have time to research him very heavily. It was too much of a side alley for me. But the brief thing I did read did talk about him having a very heavy-handed approach to civil unrest in 1915. They were like shooting people on site for, who were defying the curfew and things like this. And at least according to the Wikipedia page, his heavy-handed treatment was black. Well, some people, who I don't know which people, blamed him for kicking off the independence movement in Sri Lanka. As I say, I don't put myself to explain what's going on there, but there might be some truth to it for all I know. Now, we leap ahead. The fleet arrives in Egypt and they disembark, and we get to Christmas Day 1914. We went to the headquarters service at 10 a.m. The GOC, that's General Godley, General Officer Commanding, the GOC then said he would not want me again, so I took my first holiday. Kayalet and I lunched at Shepherd's, and after we went out to the pyramids. We were foolish enough to climb to the top. It took us 30 minutes going as hard as we could. It's well worth doing once, but I shall be quite content in future to sit at the bottom and watch others doing the climbing. And this photo on the top right doesn't show Rhodes on the top of the pyramid, but it does show a collection of other officers, including, you can see there are a couple of Gurkhas who were also there in Egypt. So it wasn't just the Australians and the New Zealanders and the British. There were plenty of French, and there were also a number of Gurkhas and various other different nationalities. The photo on the bottom right is a view of the Australian camp from the top of the pyramid. The whole place was swarming with soldiers, and it's a wonder that more don't fall off the pyramid and kill themselves. I think the present total is three, of which two are dead. None of them are our own men. Now, I don't know if my grandfather ever climbed the pyramids, but he did go because my mother remembered him saying that he had actually been inside the pyramid with one of the guards, and he had told her he really didn't like it. It felt all creepy and claustrophobic, and he didn't enjoy it at all. Did he also go to the top? Well, he never told my mother. Maybe he did. We had tea at Shepherd's and then came home and had a bath and dressed. Onslow and Kaelet dined with us at the Continental, and then we went to a music hall. And yes, there were some rather nice clubs and hotels and things like this in Cairo. Shepherd's was the most famous, there it is on the top right, but the Continental was another swanky facility where the officers would tend to hang out. But even occasionally, enlisted men would go there too. They weren't limited by rules, they were limited by price. They simply couldn't afford it most of the time. But occasionally for a special treat, some of them did go. And then another part of his diary. Walford is a most extraordinary man. I like him very much. Amongst other accomplishments, he married an American and is now divorced in America, but not in England. And that's Captain, I think his name's Garth Walford on the right. I really couldn't learn an awful lot about him. But what does he mean about being divorced in America, but not in England? Well, I expect it's something to do with divorce law that I actually encountered with a fellow teacher when I was working in Hong Kong many years ago. And this American teacher had married a mainland Chinese girl. And he wasn't able to get her into Hong Kong because they had serious restrictions against Hong Kong men marrying mainland Chinese wives and bringing them in. It was very difficult with a waiting list, a waiting time of years. But if she had an American green card, he could get her in right away. So that's what he did. He sponsored her for an American green card, not because he wanted to take her to America, but just because he wanted her to join him in Hong Kong. So he did this, and it worked. And then sometime later, that relationship broke down, and they got divorced. And then he found himself a different girl to marry from mainland China. So, you know, he married her, and then he went to apply for an American green card and found out that he was still married to the first one, as far as the Americans were concerned. And what he told me was, I think he was from Virginia, so this might only apply to Virginia, or maybe it applies to the whole of the United States, I'm not sure. What he told me was that American law would recognize overseas marriages, but it wouldn't recognize overseas divorces. So it recognized the fact that he'd married his first wife, but didn't recognize the fact that he'd divorced her in Hong Kong. So when he married the second one, he was a bigamist because they didn't recognize the first divorce. So then he had to divorce his first wife a second time, but this time in the United States. And then he had to marry his second wife a second time to make it legal in the eyes of American law. And I'm sure that's probably something similar was what was going on with Walford. Now, the fellow in the middle who's leaning down over the map, that is Charles Paget, 6th Marquess of Anglesey. And when I first set out to make this episode, the whole thing was going to be centered around him and some stuff that was going on around him. And in fact, it was actually quite related to this aspect of, you know, British officers marrying Americans and scandal and trouble that came about amongst it. And that is going to be my follow-up episode. So remember that name, in his diary, Rhodes just calls him Anglesey all the time, and he even spells it wrong. But Anglesey is Charles Paget, 6th Marquess of Anglesey, a member of the British aristocracy. So we will revisit him in a few days when I finish my next episode. And then there's General Godley. General Godley, then commander of the Australian and New Zealand Division, consults with an officer in the desert close to Zaytun Camp. Now, as ADC to the general, Tahu Rhodes is going to be close by, and frequently in his diary he mentions taking his horses out for exercise and so on. So is that guy hanging around a bit behind him? Is that Tahu Rhodes? Well, it very well may be, but I've no way of confirming it. Then we leap ahead to the countdown to Gallipoli. If you know your World War One history or anything about Australia and New Zealand, you know April the 25th is our day written in history, or written in blood, if you like. That's the day when the Anzac troops will land. It's the national holiday in Australia and New Zealand, Anzac Day. And this is as they're boarding the ships and getting ready to go off. And the photo on the right is a group of other New Zealanders as they're preparing to board their troop ship, getting ready to go off to Gallipoli. So April the 12th, 1915. We left Cairo by the 9:30 a.m. train. Poor Lady G, that's Lady Godley, the wife of General Godley, poor Lady G was rather upset and was inclined to be weepy all the way. It was rather a trying journey for me. Poor old thing, I felt so sorry for her. She was terribly upset, so was the General. In other words, she's got a bit more awareness that she's seeing a lot of these boys off to war, and many of them are going to die or come home mutilated. She's fully aware of just what's involved with saying goodbye to these troops. Of course, the young men don't see it that way. Poor old thing. I felt very sorry for her. Then we went straight down to the quay and took off to the Lutsov. It is very funny going to war in a German ship. Even the toothpicks are German. Yeah, because one of the first things that happened after war broke out was both sides confiscated each other's ships. And of course, with the British Navy having much greater reach, there were a lot of German cargo ships that got confiscated and requisitioned for other purposes. And that's what happened to the Lutsov. She was now serving as a troop ship for the attack on Gallipoli. And they sailed at 5 p.m. The whole of this business is most awfully interesting and very exciting. Personally, I think we are setting off on what will turn out to be one of the biggest things in this war. And if it succeeds here and eventually goes up the Danube to Hungary, it'll be without doubt the greatest turning move the world has ever known. Well, yes, the optimism of youth. We know, of course, the Gallipoli attack is going to be a complete failure, but he's not even thinking about that. First we attack the Turks, and then we rip all the way through the Turks, and then we'll be in the Black Sea, and then we can advance up the Danube and a massive flanking maneuver against the Germans. Yes, well, the optimism of youth. Then April 25th, Gallipoli landings. Now, not surprisingly, when they landed, he didn't really have time to keep up his diary, so he had to try to reconstruct some of the daily events a couple of weeks later. And here's what he was writing. My first experience of being under fire frightened the life out of me. The band off a shrapnel has just this moment dropped 3 yards from me, and the constant stream of wounded and files of dead nearly made me sick. But after 3 days, I became absolutely callous. And now nothing affects me at all. The enemy bombarded us every morning and evening on the beach, but they do not succeed in doing much damage. And one of the places he would have been moving around, they even called Shrapnel Alley, no doubt because so much Turkish shrapnel was falling in the area. And in fact, if I remember right, the caption to this particular photo says the men are actually looking for fragments of a shell that had just gone off. May the 11th. Spent the whole morning moving headquarters. I built the general a very good dugout, about 7 foot by 7 foot, getting quite good at making things out of nothing. It is much more comfortable as well as being safer than the old place. We moved just in time. In the afternoon, 3 fat shells plumped into our old quarters. And you can see here at the top some of the more rough and ready dugouts from earlier in the troops' time at Gallipoli. And down the bottom where they're getting a bit more efficient and really packing them up. May 22nd. We were flooded out of our dugout again. General went out and I stayed in and changed his dugouts. I'm getting quite an expert dugout maker and can furnish them better than any expert could. So they're in what's nothing more than dirt holes, and they're on these steep hills. And when it rains, they just fill with water. It's just, well, horrible. What else can you call it? And here is the divisional HQ later on when they're really getting established. I mean, I wouldn't exactly call it comfortable, but comparatively speaking, it's more comfortable because there were no positions that were not within range of Turkish artillery, so they had to be in dugouts the whole downtime. And here's a photo I found from the Australian War Memorial of General Godley. He's the one facing us with his head down, consulting some of the staff at Quinn's Post, which is right up on the front line. Just over that ridge was where you'd get your head blown off by Turkish snipers or machine gun fire. And then a brief digression from Rhodes's diary, because it has a reference to Rhodes in this newspaper story. He died gallantly, published in the Evening Post, 17th of July 1915. The death of Private James Horne Aitken. The following letter from the Gallipoli Peninsula, and dated May 7th, has been received from Sir Alexander Godley by Mr. G. G. Aitken of Christchurch in reference to the death of his brother of the Canterbury Infantry Battalion. This is General Godley writing. Dear Mr. Aitken, I feel I must write a letter to express to you my very great sympathy in the death of your brother. He had been my special orderly since we landed here, and he had been invaluable to me. On the 5th, the day he was killed, he was with me as usual, carrying my telescope as he always did, and with his rifle, acting as my escort. We happened to be in one of the most forward posts when it was attacked in the afternoon by a considerable body of Turks, who, in addition to heavy rifle fire, were also throwing bombs. Some of the men were rather shaken by the explosion of a bomb in their midst, and Aitken was most cool and plucky in helping to rally them. He then helped me to extend some support that came up, and shortly afterward, the attack having been repulsed and having died away, I started to walk down the hill, thinking he was following me, and it was not till I reached the foot of the hill that I missed him. I then sent word back to let him know that I would walk slowly on down the valley and that he would catch me up. And it was not till I had gone some way and met Tahu Rhodes that we began to be uneasy about him and sent back again, with the result that, to my great grief, I heard that he'd been hit in the chest and had a lacerated wound, evidently from a bomb, and had died on the stretcher on which he was being brought down the valley. My two ADCs, Major J.G. Hughes, Jackie, Tahu Rhodes always calls him Jackie. My two ADCs, Major Jackie Hughes and Lieutenant Tahu Rhodes, have carved a wooden cross, which will be placed on his grave, and I can only repeat to you my deepest sympathy and hope that it may be some consolation to you to know that he died gallantly with his face to the enemy in the act of performing signal service and the execution of his duty. May 23rd. 4 weeks today since we landed. The more one looks back on these first few days, the more awful they seem. The Albion, an ancient battleship, went ashore off Gaba Tepe last night. He means wetter ground. Early this morning, the Canopus went over and tried to tow her off. It was quite exciting watching the show. Shore batteries were firing shrapnel over her all the time, and at 9 a.m. a warship from the Strait started firing. That's a Turkish warship firing at them, that is. The Canopus and Albion fired as hard as they could all the time and took on various targets. At 10 a.m., the Albion was afloat again. She only had a few men wounded. And I was delighted to find at the Imperial War Museum a photo of this exact action. That battleship there is indeed the Albion. And if you look carefully, you can see there's actually a rope. I'll try to use the computer mouse. There we go. There's a rope leading from the Albion all the way down here. And what we're looking at there is actually the Canopus that gets a mention as she is towing her from the place where she's run aground. So, yeah, I was not only did I think the story was interesting, but actually managed to bring you a picture showing you exactly what it looked like. Now, later on, May the 23rd. The smell is getting appalling, and the sooner they have an armistice, the better. In one place, where they put out a sap, there are feet and boots of dead Turks sticking out into the trench. But there is going to be an armistice tomorrow from 7:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. Now, just to give you the context of what's going on, so here's ANZAC, where the Australians and New Zealanders have landed, and they've been trying to advance up along these ridges. The Turks hold the positions over here, and there were attacks going in both directions. So Turkish attacks coming down, Anzac attacks going up, and it was all in this area where the bloody fighting had happened. And it was, of course, it was a deadly no man's land, and many, many corpses belonging to both sides were littered about. May 24th. There was an armistice between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. to bury the dead. Godley and I went up to Pope's Hill with General Birdwood at 10 a.m. I have never in all my life seen such an awful sight as met our eyes there. The whole space between the trenches was strewn with dead, some blown to bits by shellfire, some half skeletons, others killed recently swelled up to twice their normal size. The smell was terrific and made me feel quite sick. The majority of the bodies were too rotten to touch, so holes were dug near them and they were pulled in with picks and shovels. I should think quite 3,000 dead Turks were buried and a good many of our own men. There was no ill feeling between the Turks and our men, and at Quinn's Post they shook hands and wished each other luck before returning to their respective trenches. We spent 4 hours walking about. It was very curious being able to get out of the trenches and walk about in front of them in perfect safety. Shortly after 4:30 p.m., firing again broke out. It rained very hard between 7 to 10 p.m., and our dugout was as usual like a shower bath. I cannot imagine a more loathsome, depressing day than this one has been. And that actually is a photo of the Armistice Day, of the men who are out there, all the burial parties, and going about their gruesome, horrible work. May 25th. About 12:05 p.m., I witnessed a thing that I'd often read about, seen pictures of, and talked about, i.e., a large battleship torpedoed and sunk. I heard someone cry, "Good God, the Triumph's hit!" Looked up, and sure enough, saw a great cloud of smoke rising from her about amidships and on starboard side. She immediately developed a heavy list to starboard, and one could see all the crew mustering on her decks. At 12:10 p.m., a destroyer managed to get alongside her and took off a large number of men in the short space of 2 minutes. A second destroyer had just arrived when she very slowly started to turn over. The men still aboard had to jump and swim for it. She turned completely over and floated bottom up, looking like a great red whale. By this time, there were quite a dozen destroyers and trawlers standing by. As far as one could see, practically everyone was rescued, except those killed in the explosion and the men who were below decks when she turned over. At 12:45 p.m., her stern heaved up in the air, and she dived slowly down to the bottom. 30 seconds after she disappeared, the boilers exploded, and the surface of the sea for a radius of about 200 yards became a foaming mass of spars and wreckage of all kinds. And Tahu Rhodes that day was actually out on the water because he and the general were out looking for possible flanking maneuvers they could do to try to get round the Turks. So they were actually out on the water and had a very close view of what was going on. And this painting at the top does indeed show the sinking of the Triumph. And there's a photo of the Triumph before she sank back in the Suez Canal. She had actually been part of the East Asia Squadron that had been opposite the German East Asia Squadron, based out of Hong Kong and that kind of area, and had been brought to the Middle East for the action. Now she wasn't needed in the East anymore. And to my amazement, as I searched through the photos on the New Zealand National Army Museum, I actually found a photo album containing two photos of sailors from HMS Triumph after they'd been rescued. On the left, they're taking a roll call. I mean, very important after a disaster like this. You see, there's the officer, and they're going through, and they're basically calling roll call. Who survived? Who's missing? And on the right, well, there they are, just looking a bit shell-shocked, really, don't they? So this is not just some random stylized pictures of guys hanging around aboard a some ship. No, these are actual survivors of the sinking of the Triumph just after they've been rescued. And Tahu Rhodes wrote, "The rescued men seem half dazed." And he carried on. "The Turks behaved in a most gentlemanly way. She sank within range of the shore batteries, which poured shrapnel over her until it was obvious that she was settling. They then ceased fire absolutely while the work of rescuing the crew was going on. The presence of the submarine is a most serious business for us, and it means we are entirely deprived of all support from the naval guns and places our supply of water and food in a very precarious position. It is a perfectly damnable thing to think three miserable little submarines can defy a whole fleet of battleships and drive them into a harbour where they're surrounded by booms, etc. It also has its humorous side. We came here to assist the Navy to force the Dardanelles, and what has happened is the Navy's run away as fast as they can and left us to do the job alone. And the photo below, also National Army Museum, is a British submarine, but I thought appropriate for a passage of text like this. May the 29th. Enemy exploded mine and attacked Quinn's at dawn, but were successfully repelled. The general and I walked up the valley at about 11 a.m., went up Pope's and Quinn's posts. When we were at Quinn's, they were throwing bombs badly, so General did not go into the fire trench. Quinn was killed this morning, I'm sorry to say. Our casualties were about 260. General, a little liverish and very worried, walks about damning everyone he sees to heaps. It is a pity he gets like this. Well, the general in command's had a day where his force has suffered 260 casualties. He's lost the heavy guns and the naval support and the logistics thing. The Turks are fully aware of this, and they're throwing strong attacks against the positions. I think there was plenty for him to feel pretty unhappy with. And this photo on the right, as it says, Monash Gully looking up towards Quinn's. So you see these are the slopes they were at, and up to that ridge line. And once you get over that ridge, well, then let's say the Turkish machine guns and snipers can take you out once you put your head above that ridge. And Quinn's post was indeed named after a fellow called Quinn. He was an Australian. There he is. He was a major, Hugh Quinn. Well, he was a captain when he went to Gallipoli. He received a field promotion while he was there, so he died a major, Major Hugh Quinn. And he had been responsible for capturing Quinn's Hill on April the 29th, 4 days after they'd landed at Gallipoli. And it was absolutely critical, because if they didn't hold that position, the Turks would have been able to just shoot down into all of the ANZAC positions, and their position on the beaches would have been completely untenable. By holding the ridge, they could at least keep a sheltered area that wasn't under direct observation of Turkish positions. And just to give you, a sense of what's going on, so down here on the bottom left, you see ANZAC Cove. There's Shrapnel Valley, or Shrapnel Alley, as I've seen it called elsewhere. And then as you go further up, you see it goes to Monash Gully. And then you can see these ridge lines. There's Quinn's Post and Pope's Hill. And both of these locations feature heavily in Tahu Rhodes' diary. The general is frequently going up right into the front lines to see what's going on. But really, all things considered, there's nowhere that's not really the front line. As I said, everywhere is within range of the Turkish guns up on the top, up in positions like Chunuk Bear. And this is a photo, actually, of artillery fire. Shell burst close to Quinn's, as it says the caption at the National Army Museum. And here's another one. View from Quinn's Post into no man's land. Yeah, that's, you can't really blame the photographer for not getting a very good shot, because, well, sticking your head out there, I quite imagine the camera was probably just being held up with a shaky hand and there wasn't even a head behind it. And then Pope's Hill looking up to Sari Bar Hill. So again, it's pretty rough countryside, and they're stuck between here and down to the coast, which is off to the left of this photo. And another one, Pope's Hill looking towards Walker's Ridge. So that's, again, go up to the right, to the top of that slope. That's where you're going to get your head shot off. And Walker's Ridge, well, that's looking across to the left flank. And you can see some of these bivouacs and canvas that are spread as the men have dug themselves into the side of the hill. And there's a soldier guarding Pope's Hill, and another one looking up to Pope's Hill and Quinn's Post. Pope's Hill on the left, Quinn's Post on the right. May 31st. I walked out to see how George and the rest of the men were after last night. Found them all very pleased with themselves. They'd managed to hold off a Turkish attack. After talking to GF in his dugout for about half an hour, I discovered he had been punctured in the tail. The silly old ass hadn't had it dressed or anything and said it did not hurt. I argued with him and eventually persuaded him to walk down to the beach and have it properly washed and seen to. Colonel Begg fixed him up and, much to his annoyance, ordered him to go away to Mudros for a week or two. He was perfectly furious, but once one gets into the doctor's hands, it is no use arguing. Now, that's Colonel Begg at the top right. I mentioned him in my last episode, the one that I was talking about the dentist. And, well, anyway, you can go back and watch that if you're interested. He died in 1918 of pneumonia. And on the bottom right, you can see here's some wounded men making their way down from Quinn's Post down to the beach. And you can see this poor guy there seems to have been badly hit around the head. June 3rd now. A lot of stores arrived for us from Cairo, including some very nice chocolate, lemon drops, peppermint, etc. from Anglesey. Remember I told you they became good friends. Also, some small carbide lamps, which are a very great boon for working by at night. Very quiet all day as regards both shell and rifle fire. The flies are getting very bad indeed. Our dugout is simply full of the brutes. Now, this photo, I found it on the National Army Museum, but without context. So they don't know where this photo was taken, somewhere in the Middle East, I assume. And the captions, that the handwritten caption that went with the photo says, "Enjoying freedom from flies, writing home under the protection of mosquito netting." And you can see there's a fellow with mosquito netting all over him and only his boots are sticking out. So anyway, it was the most appropriate photo I could find when I was looking for some World War I photo involving flies. And there's a Turkish prisoner at Gallipoli being led down to the lower positions by a New Zealand soldier. June 4th, at 11 p.m. we made an attack from Quinn's and captured trench in front of that post. Heavy fighting all night. 31 prisoners came in at 2 p.m. Rhodes says 2 p.m, but from context I'm sure he means 2 a.m. I'm sure it's a typo. 31 prisoners came in at 2 a.m. I fed them and gave opium to some of the wounded ones. Turned in for a couple of hours at 5 a.m. During the day, there was a very heavy bombardment down south. June 5th. At 7 a.m, we were forced to retire from trench we captured last night. Quinn's is a really damnable place. This is the fourth time we've taken their trench, each time to be turned out again in the morning by bombs and machine guns. It was just a brutal affair, back and forth, and every time you went back or forth, you lost more men, both sides. Our casualties were one officer killed and eight wounded, about 60 men killed and wounded, and 48 missing. We can only hope that the Turks suffered much more heavily. As far as we can hear, the attack at the south was about as successful as ours on Quinn's. In other words, it wasn't successful at all. And, as I said, the price every time is more dead bodies. There's a line of six graves at Gallipoli and probably some others in the background, I imagine. June 7th. We made another attack from Quinn's, but I'm afraid the men's hearts were not in it, and it would be stretching too great a point to call it a success. Bed at 9 p.m, feeling like a boiled owl, tummy out of order, head, and generally out of sorts. Well, I put this one in purely because I thought that was such a strange expression, which I had to look up. What does it mean to say you're feeling like a boiled owl? When I first looked up the saying, it seemed to imply you were drunk, but that didn't seem to fit the context, so I had to dig a bit deeper. And it was being used around this time period of World War I to mean exhausted from nerves. There were some various theories about why exactly feeling like a boiled owl was being exhausted from nerves or later to be drunk, but they may or may not be real. But let's carry on. June 13th, 7 long weeks today since we landed, and I shall think we shall be here another 6 weeks. Well, he thought he was being pessimistic. We know that they'll be there till December, and then they will evacuate in defeat. June 15th. We walked and crawled all through fire trenches and mine and saps and Courtney's and Quinn's posts. Back to beach at 1 p.m. Went aboard the destroyer Bulldog and steamed over to Embrus, 18 miles. Took me a while to work out that it was another spelling mistake on his part. He's talking about Imbros. I went straight on to the Admiral's yacht, HMS Triad, where we stayed the night. The yacht is most luxuriously fitted up, about 2,000 tons and quite fast. Apparently the Admiralty bought it off a rich American exactly for this purpose. After tea, lay about and read the English papers, had a hot bath before dinner, and was perfectly horrified at the colour of the water afterwards. After most excellent dinner, we talked till 11:30 p.m. and then went to bed. A genuine bed with sheets and silk pyjamas. I don't think I've ever spent such a curious day. Walked about in the morning within 10 yards of the enemy's trenches, looked in at a hospital hut on the way back to the beach and saw a man who had been shot through the brain giving his dying kick. In the afternoon, went 18 miles on a destroyer at 22 knots, got on to a modern yacht, sat down to dinner, exactly as though one was dining with an admiral in peacetime. In the morning, we saw war with all its horrors. In the evening, one might have been visiting an admiral during a review at Spithead. Meanwhile, back in Egypt again, from another New Zealand newspaper story, was this one from the groom of Tahu Rhodes. In other words, he had a man assigned to him to look after his horses. Trooper W. Taylor, groom to Lieutenant Tahu Rhodes, writes on June 25th to friends in Christchurch that despite two trips to Gallipoli, he had to return to Egypt each time, as the horses were not yet required. The men looking after the animals are encamped on a beach in Alexandria, and it is only two steps out of the tents into the water. There are thousands of horses in Egypt, he says, for which there is no use at present, the country on the Gallipoli Peninsula being too rough. Well, if you've watched some of my earlier episodes, you'll know that this is of particular interest to me, because this is the exact reason why my grandfather also did not land at Gallipoli. When the New Zealand Mounted Field Ambulance was sent out, they went out with all their horses and wagons, and then all the other men of the unit remained behind, but the wagons, the horses, and the men who cared for them, who included my grandfather, was sent back to Egypt. So my grandfather would have been in exactly the same position as Trooper Taylor. Now, on June 25th, Tahu Rhodes was ill again, and the general on this occasion decided that he needed to be sent back to hospital in Egypt for some treatment. So on July the 1st, he was back in Egypt, and there was a brief comment there that I noted. He wrote, "I bought a gramophone to take back to amuse us at ANZAC." I mean, he wrote a lot of other things too, but I just wanted to put that for context. Then on July the 3rd, he was judged to be sufficiently recovered, and he set sail to return to Gallipoli. And then we get this entry from July the 12th about that gramophone he had bought. "After dinner, we played the gramophone, and when Caruso sang Pagliacci," well, I looked it up as Pagliacci from 1897, "and Because," which was a new release, only released in 1913, "I felt so homesick I did not know what to do. At times, the crack of the rifle was so loud that one could scarcely hear what was being played. It seemed quite uncanny. Very little shelling on the beach today, more in the trenches. As I'm writing this, there's a bunch of tech violets sitting in front of me. How I wish I could fly back to where they came from." In other words, somebody had sent him some dried flowers and he was just having an emotional moment. Now, I had to look up, of course, Pagliacci, and it's actually a fairly well-known song. You might recognize it. And this is, I'm pushing my skills in terms of tech. I think I can play this clip and you'll be able to hear it. Just a little bit, enough for you to recognize the tune. It was about there I wanted to play.
Thank you.
Now, imagine you're listening to that at Gallipoli. You're stuck in your dugout. It's July. Remember, the landings were in April. And it reminds you of home, but it's also, I mean, pretty heart-rending music. You can well imagine Tahu Rhodes' feelings. And of course, don't forget to overlay the sound of occasional shrapnel bursts going off and rifle fire just to, you know, add some counterpoint to the music. Whoops. And then July 15th. No special excitement. We were shelled off and on during the whole day as usual. A doctor called Campbell had both his legs cut off by a shell while he was bathing in the evening. He died shortly afterwards. I'm feeling fairly well, but this is an enervating place, and one is rather inclined to feel a bit slack. And of course, everyone is absolutely fed up and sick of the whole show. Well, the thing that really struck me here was just how, oh yeah, nothing happening much. Oh yeah, this guy got his legs blown off and was dead. And yeah, nothing going on. It just seems so commonplace by the middle of July. Oh yeah, another guy died. Yeah, nothing out of the ordinary. Anyway, let's carry on with the diary entry. How anyone can say they like war defeats me altogether, and I don't believe them. If anyone had told us when we just landed that we should still be sitting here in 3 months' time, no one would have believed him. Personally, I think with any luck, we ought to have finished this show off by the end of September. It is to be hoped that it will be over by then, for there would be no fun about a winter campaign on this peninsula. Well, as I said, he thinks he's being pessimistic. And I looked up to find out who this was. I initially thought he must be a New Zealand doctor, but I eventually identified him as an Australian, Dr. Sydney James Campbell. There's his photo. And when you start digging, sometimes it's amazing what you could find. At the Australian War Memorial, I found his diary, copies of letters he wrote home, all sorts of things. And there was what he wrote in the front of his diary. There's his name or his autograph, if you like. S.J. Campbell, Captain, AMC, Australian Medical Corps, Medical Officer, 8th Light Horse, 3rd Light Horse Brigade of the Australians, that is. And I found at the National Army Museum this photo, which was a group of men who were bathing at the beach. And in fact, the caption on the photo even says, snipers trying their luck. So what a strange thing, where they were so inured to danger that they would go down occasionally to swim in the water and get a bit cleaner, even knowing that every now and again a Turkish artillery shell would land and send shrapnel spraying everywhere, or snipers would take pot shots at them at extreme long range. But oh well, what's the difference? I can have a swim in the sea, or I could get shot. Well, yeah, who knows? Let's see. Now, as I said, there were letters from that Dr. Campbell, and in fact, his last letter home was written just a couple of days before he was killed. Most of it was written on July 12th, but there's a brief note at the end before he sent it off, dated July 14th. And this was his very last comment to his family at home. He wrote, "Fancy almost a year since the war started. Your loving brother, Sid. P.S. Keep the sketches. I would also like you to keep my letters. I might find them interesting someday." Well, no, he wouldn't, because he'd never get home. But obviously the family valued all of these records. And at some point, they donated them to the Australian War Memorial. And now they're scanned and available for the likes of me to read. And he mentioned sketches. Oh, there's a whole collection of sketches. And here's an example. He was somewhat talented as an artist, I think. And it's very recognizable. There's Anzac Cove. You know, this comment down here on the right, the landing of the Australians and New Zealanders took place on this beach. And lots of other comments. And he has quite a number of other sketches in there too, really laying out the terrain and the positions of what was going on. Really rather interesting. And of course, tragic. And also amongst those other documents, there were three letters of condolence sent to Dr. Campbell's mother. And, well, I'll give you a quote from one of them. Mervyn Bourne Higgins wrote to Campbell's mother to tell him how her son had died and to, you know, say all the normal things about I'm terribly sorry and he was a terribly nice man and all of the rest. And this was the letterhead that was on the letter. In fact, I took a scan and put it in there. So this is the letterhead from the actual letter he sent to the mother. You can see it's got the 8th Light Horse of the Australian Imperial Force. And as I was looking him up, I discovered that he didn't survive the war either. He was killed in a battle in the Sinai Peninsula. It was a victory, hard fought. Both the Australian and New Zealand Light Horse back on horseback fighting as mounted infantry as they were originally intended to fight, dislodged Ottoman positions in the Sinai Peninsula, so it was a victory. But of course, even in a victory, men die, and the man who wrote this letter was destined to die in that battle. But here's what he wrote to Dr. Campbell's mother. This is how it happened. The evening before last, Sid left our regimental camp here with the commanding officer and adjutant to have a swim down at the base about a mile away. They undressed on a barge and were just ready to go into the sea. The CO had stepped off on another barge and Deb, the adjutant, was bending down about 2 feet in front of Sid, who was standing. An 8-inch shell came along and caught Sid sideways on, cutting off both legs below the knee before it burst in the bottom of the barge, where it wounded 3 or 4 others. There was a field ambulance within a few yards and he was brought in less than a minute. He was conscious for a few seconds and gave the stretcher bearers instructions as to tying him up, but he was unconscious by the time he got into the ambulance hospital, from which he was soon removed to the hospital ship. He died about 1 o'clock the following yesterday morning. I know how agonizing these details must be to you, but I thought you'd prefer to know exactly how it happened, and I've given them to you just as Deb gave them to me. All his belongings have been collected, and I expect that in due course they'll be sent home. With my deepest sympathy with you and all your family, I remain yours very truly, M.B. Higgins. Back to Rhodes, July 19th. Woke up with most alarming pains in Little Mary. Had very bad diarrhea all day. Was not able to take even brandy. The only thing that did not make me sick was soda water. Lay down in my dugout all day. Now, the only really reason I included that was because, you know, they had these funny sayings like feeling like a boiled owl. And when I saw that, I thought, Little Mary, is that some euphemism for a part of the male anatomy that people don't usually like to name? And I looked it up, and to my surprise, it doesn't mean that at all. It just means stomach. Again, don't ask me why. So alarming pains in my stomach. Why he calls it Little Mary and not a stomach, I cannot tell you. But it certainly, by context, fits, you know, having very bad diarrhea, etc. August the 2nd, my 22nd birthday. What a place to spend a birthday in. Oh, for goodness sake, I don't know why my dog is barking, but I'll just carry on in here. August 2nd, my 22nd birthday. What a place to spend a birthday in. At 11 a.m., the general, Cox, and several other officers and self went out in the destroyer Colne and spent the day cruising up and down our left flank. They gave us an excellent lunch, and I thoroughly enjoyed myself. A very peaceful day. As I sat on the deck and looked at the sea, how I wished I was bound for New Zealand and not just cruising around in a circle. We landed again at 9 p.m. Now, I found at the Imperial War Museum a model of the Colne. She had actually been accompanying the Triumph. She had been attached as a tender to the HMS Triumph as part of the East Asia Squadron and had come through to the Middle East from Asia with her. And I found this photo on the New Zealand National Army Museum that was captioned a destroyer unidentified at ANZAC. And I can't promise you that it's the Colne, but comparing the profile and that rather interesting frontage and the chimneys and other things, I think there's quite a good chance that actually this destroyer that they couldn't identify is actually the Colne. Who knows? Maybe that's actually the day when Tahu Rhodes was sailing around on it. August 4th. Everyone is frightfully busy at present preparing for our great attack. Last night and tonight, the 13th Division were landed. We're all feeling optimistic at this moment. If we can only give the old Turks a good knock, I feel certain it'll have a very far-reaching result. bed, 1 a.m. Well, the short version is it didn't go well. They pushed hard, they captured a bit of ground, and they suffered horrendous casualties. And then at the top right, there is General Godley. He's the one figure on the left, and he's talking to a bunch of Australians, including Australian Colonel Bull John Macquarie Antle. And I, again, don't have time to pursue every little side alley in great depth, so I just relied on Wikipedia in this case. I know I'd hate to do it, but sometimes you just run out of time. And here's what it wrote about Colonel Antle's performance that day. During the fierce fighting at the Neck, Antle, now in temporary command of the brigade, refused a request from the commander of the 10th Light Horse, Lieutenant Colonel Noel Brazier, to cancel the third wave. Part of the fourth wave also went over the top before Brazier and some officers from the 8th Light Horse Regiment reached Hughes in time to call off any further waves. Out of around 500 men committed to the attack, more than half became casualties, with 234 being killed and 138 wounded. So you can see here, here's the Neck. Quinn's Post was a little bit further down, and they were coming up over the ridge into an exposed position into a hail of Turkish machine gun fire, which is described as unsuppressed. In other words, no counterfire of New Zealand or Australian machine guns nor artillery was suppressing the Turkish fire. It was a massacre. And I can't help wondering if that might have been the scene portrayed in Mel Gibson's very early movie called Gallipoli. August 9th. At 5 p.m., someone rushed to my dugout and said, "The Turks were on us." I leaped out and rushed up the hill from where we could see the whole thing quite plainly. The Turks had evidently got up a tremendous lot of reinforcements and were making a desperate effort to drive us into the sea. We were forced to retire from the top of Chunuk Bear and other places along the whole line. Chunuk Bear is the top of the ridge there. That was the highest position the New Zealanders ever reached. They briefly reached the top of the ridge, but they were driven back by Turkish counterattacks, and that was the furthest they ever reached. The Turks suffered appalling casualties, both from machine gun and ship artillery fire. By midday, we'd finally beaten off the attack, and by evening, all was quiet and peaceful, both armies being absolutely done. The Australians and New Zealanders had suffered appalling casualties in the attack, and the Turks had suffered equally appalling casualties in their massed counterattack, and neither had really achieved anything for all of their losses. And then, it is now the 27th of August, and I'm afraid I have rather forgotten what has happened during the last 9 days. We seem to have settled down here. Unless a miracle happens, nothing can save us from spending the winter here, ... And then there's another long interruption in the writing of his diary, and when he resumes, he wrote this. Interrupted here and now, it is more difficult than ever to remember what has happened, as the date is 11th of September, and I am in Malta. Because he had been medically evacuated, and he was judged serious enough that it wasn't just sent back to Egypt. He was sent on to one of the better hospitals at Malta. This is one of them in the photo. And then, from a newspaper announcement, Dardanelle's casualties. Lieutenant Tahu Rhodes, Mr. A.E.G. Rhodes, that's his father, has been advised that his son, Lieutenant Tahu Rhodes, ADC to Major General Sir Alexander Godley, has been invalided from Malta to England, where he was admitted to the 18 Cadogan Gardens Hospital, London, on the 23rd inst, which means 23rd of September in this context, suffering from influenza. Lieutenant Rhodes is 22 years old. And I looked it up, and it was a posh place for officers. Like, there were only 8 or 12 beds at maximum, where they were all treated very, very well. Because, well, I guess Rhodes was an officer, and he was, well, as I said, he tended to move in the upper circles. And while he was there, he got married. Now, this Captain Tahu Rhodes of Christchurch and his bride, the Honourable Helen Plunket, a report of the wedding was published in yesterday's Star. Our photo was taken immediately after the ceremony at Lord Plunket's residence. And, well, it's a pretty shocking photo and you can't see it very well. Luckily, That's what you get from past papers, New Zealand, when they scanned in the newspaper photos. Luckily, I was able to find elsewhere a much better version of the photo. It's actually quite interesting to compare these photos because you get a very different impression. Like when I look at that one on the left, I imagine this quite senior, old British officer with a moustache. You look at him on the right, he just looks so very young. In fact, they both look like practically children. It's actually incredible to think that here he is, having been through all that stuff in Gallipoli, and he just looks like a child. Now, well, his wife, yes. Why is she called the Honourable Helen Plunket? Well, Tahu Rhodes married well, shall we say. These are her parents. There is Lord Plunket and Lady Plunket. Lord Plunket had actually been Governor General, no, not Governor General, he was called Governor of New Zealand for quite a few years. And yes, Tahu Rhodes was marrying into British aristocracy. There's a newspaper story. Lord Plunket's eldest daughter, the Honourable Helen Plunket, that was, it's a strange expression there. Helen Plunket that was. Well, she's not Helen Plunket anymore because now she's Helen Rhodes, but back then she was Helen Plunket. A strange expression. Okay. Lord Plunket's eldest daughter, Helen Plunket, that was, who was married to Captain Tahu Rhodes recently, is just 20. She was in her early teens when she was in New Zealand, and it is said that the marriage to Captain Rhodes, who was a Christchurch boy, is the continuance of a boy and girl friendship. It is said that she has grown into an exceedingly pretty young woman with masses of dark hair and very dark and beautiful eyes. She is the eldest of a family of eight, and her bridegroom is an officer in the Grenadier Guards. Well, we'll talk a little bit about how he comes to be assigned to the Grenadier Guards in a moment. And over on the right, that is the shield of the Plunkets. This Lord Plunket is the fifth Lord Plunket. There were, as I say, there would have been four of them before him. And on the wedding certificate, I thought this was hilarious. Under the wife's father's name, it says rank or profession of father, baron. So, what do you do for a living? I'm a baron. And but at the same time, Tahu Rhodes' father just said, "What is your rank?" My rank is esquire. Don't even ask me what that means. And then more newspaper story. In the Guards Chapel, Wellington Barracks, London, on January the 25th, this couple was married to the Honourable Helen Plunket, formerly Governor of the Dominion. I skipped out too much text. Tahu Rhodes was married to Helen Plunket, daughter of Lord Plunket, who was formerly Governor of the Dominion. Early arrivals in the church were New Zealand soldiers brought from the hospital at Walton-on-Thames in Red Cross motor vans, driven by girls wearing khaki overalls and hats with New Zealand on the shoulder straps. Well, if you go back and watch my episode all about Mrs. Goodchild, you'll know all about that. The bridesmaids gave to each of them a pink carnation as a favour. The Bishop of Tuam, uncle of the bride, officiated, assisted by the chaplain of the Brigade of Guards. The bride was given away by her father. Captain and the Honourable Mrs. Rhodes left for Bean Des Desert, Rugley, Staff, Staffordshire, that is, lent by the Marquis of Anglesey. Now, again, remember I said the friend Anglesey? Well, there he is. He's back in England at the same time. And he said, "Oh, yes, you go and use my country estate." And I couldn't find photos of this wedding except the one I showed you earlier, but I did find wounded New Zealanders from Walton-on-Thames attending a different wedding in July of 1917. So there they all are at the wedding of Major Fergus getting married to Nurse Gibbon. And one more. Captain Tahu Rhodes is expected to arrive in the Dominion shortly on a month's furlough, accompanied by his wife and daughter. So this is the end of the war. It's October 1918. Captain Rhodes joined the 1st New Zealand Expeditionary Force, and after service at Gallipoli, where he was invalided to England, he rejoined his own regiment, the Grenadiers. In 18 months' service in France, he has been once wounded in the arm and once gassed. Now, when people hear about Grenadier Guards, they think about these fellows. There's a photo I took in London of the Crimean War Memorial. But, no, they didn't look like that in World War One. They looked pretty much like any other British officers, but the Grenadier Guards were indeed there fighting in the war. And then, as I continued to research Tahu Rhodes after World War One was over, I came across this photo that was published in a newspaper in May of 1920. And there is Tahu Rhodes in the back, somewhat older than he used to be, but again, poor quality photo. There is his wife. So I remember I said they were moving in high circles. Well, guess who that is? That's Edward, Prince of Wales. He would briefly become king. He's, if you've seen the King's Speech or know the story of the scandal, he was the one who was involved with a divorced American woman and was ultimately forced to abdicate in favor of his brother. So there he is. And there's some other pretty famous people there too. That's Lord Louis Mountbatten. If you watch that TV series, The Queen, or know your history, you'll know he's the one who was actually murdered when his fishing boat had the IRA put a bomb on it and blew him up along with a couple of teenage boys and a bunch of other people. The IRA called it an execution, but it was just murder, plain and simple. And a number of the other people in there are pretty important too, but those were the two most senior of the British aristocracy. And then another newspaper story involving Tahu Rhodes. Now, this one was published in 1936. This was while Edward was king, that brief window before he abdicated. But it's recalling an incident when he visited New Zealand when he was the Prince of Wales, and at the time when this photo was taken. So, incident and Edward VIII's visit to Stratford. An interesting incident in the New Zealand tour of King Edward VIII, who was then the Prince of Wales, which gave Stratford the distinction of being the only centre in New Zealand where the Prince performed a ceremony such as the unveiling of a roll of honour and performed it without question, though the ceremony was not part of the official itinerary. The incident was due to an inadvertent omission on the part of Captain Tahu Rhodes, who was responsible for the civil itinerary of the tour. The Prince of Wales did something here he did not do anywhere else in New Zealand. He unveiled the Roll of Honour in the entranceway to the municipal buildings, the Mayor Macmillan stated. He explained that before the tour, instructions were issued that there should not be any ceremonies of the type that Stratford wished the royal visitor to perform. During an advance visit, however, Captain Tahu Rhodes was approached by Mr. Macmillan, who asked if it would be possible to arrange to have the ceremony included. Captain Tahu Rhodes said he would see to it, and the Stratford authorities made arrangements accordingly. The king unveiled the roll. After the ceremony, the mayor continued, I thank Captain Tahu Rhodes for having made the necessary arrangements, and he told me he had forgotten to make them. The king, Mr. Macmillan added, must have thought I was rather cheeky in asking him to unveil the roll of honour without notice. So I'm interested, why did they say you're not to ask the Prince of Wales to perform any ceremonies like, you know, cutting of ribbons while he's there? But then he had it kind of spring on him at the last minute. Well, you're going to do it. He could hardly back out and say no at the time. And a bit of embarrassment on the part of Tahu Rhodes. He said, oopsie, I forgot to arrange that. Sorry. And then another story to continue the, just to polish up the story of Tahu Rhodes. Meadowbank sold, Captain Tahu Rhodes leaving for England. Captain Tahu Rhodes is sold as well-known property, Meadowbank has been in the Rhodes family for many years. The house stands in beautiful grounds, in which have been planted a remarkably fine collection of New Zealand natives, trees and shrubs. Captain Rhodes, with the Honourable Mrs. Rhodes and family, leave New Zealand, and I can't even spell New Zealand, goodness me, leave New Zealand for England in April. Yes, so it was in 1926, or maybe possibly 1927. I think it was 1927. They moved to England and, well, never left. There he is as a somewhat of an older man. And remember I told you right at the beginning that he died in 1947. Well, a tribute to Major Tahu Rhodes by General Sir Alexander Godley, who commanded the 1st New Zealand Expeditionary Force, was published recently by the Times of London. Major Rhodes' death occurred in London on March 11th, 1947. Now, this photo was taken of General Godley on April the 25th, 1948. So just about a year after Tahu Rhodes died. So that's roughly what he would have looked like when he wrote this obituary for Tahu Rhodes. It probably surprised and saddened him that As a very old man, he had outlived his much younger ADC. Now, I cannot tell you what he died of. I know one of his sons died of lung cancer. But does that mean Tahu Rhodes died of lung cancer? I did look and I could find no details to explain why he died at such a relatively young age. General Godley wrote, Major Tahu Rhodes, whose death was recently announced. Educated in New Zealand, Tahu came to England in order to join the Special Reserve of the Grenadier Guards. Returning to New Zealand, he became my ADC and served in that capacity for the first 2 years of the 1914 to 1918 war in Egypt, at Gallipoli, and in France. He was one of the greatest help to me, as he had a charming personality and was the most popular with all with whom he came in contact. He then returned to regimental duty and served with the battalion of his regiment in France. After the war, he returned to New Zealand, where he farmed for some years, and when the Prince of Wales visited the country, he was attached to his staff and was awarded the MVO, that's the Member of the Victorian Order, for his services. Later, he returned to this country and went into business. At the outbreak of the 1939-45 war, he rejoined his regiment and was employed as an RTO, eventually becoming senior RTO of the London District. Subsequently, he served in the War Office till the cessation of hostilities. Now, I think an RTO is a railway transport officer, but I can't promise that's true. He married the Honourable Helen Plunket, eldest daughter of the 5th Baron Plunket, an old childhood friend at the time when Lord Plunket was Governor of New Zealand and had 2 sons and 3 daughters. He'll be greatly missed by many friends and brother officers, both in this country and in New Zealand. Now, as I was looking up him, I couldn't help stumbling across some details about his eldest son, so his second child but oldest boy, Dennis Gravener Rhodes. And if you look up his Wikipedia page, you'll see he's most well known for writing a book called The Syndicate. Fear, greed, and desire turn men into beasts and the race for uranium. And the action is set in a country in Africa. I forget which one. And remarkably enough, later on, it was actually made into a movie of the same name called The Syndicate. Dennis Rhodes's wife later wrote that the movie didn't really have much connection to the book itself. But isn't that the way it goes when they make movies? But even though they call him an author, Dennis Rhodes' main claim to fame wasn't through his fiction. It was, again, through his attachments to the high English nobility. I first realized this when I stumbled across this photo in a newspaper story from 1954. Princess Margaret, this is sister to Queen Elizabeth II, Princess Margaret sees her first 3D film. Princess Margaret at a London cinema last week, when she attended the European premiere of the three-dimensional coloured film Kiss Me, Kate. With Her Royal Highness is Mr. Dennis Rhodes, who is examining his 3D spectacles before the performance. Mr. Rhodes is the elder son of the late Major Tahu Rhodes. Ah, but it wasn't Princess Margaret who really was the main one, because just as Tahu Rhodes married very well indeed, so did Dennis Rhodes. Who is this young lady? Well, she was Margaret Elphinstone, who was a first cousin to Queen Elizabeth II. And this is a photo on the bottom left of their wedding. And yes, that is the king. That is, I always called her the Queen Mother because that's what I always knew her as, but she was the queen at the time. And there's Prince Philip in the background, and presumably future Queen Elizabeth II would have also been at the wedding. And in fact, if you're interested in the whole story of that family, his wife, Margaret Elphinstone, who became Margaret Rhodes, has written a best-selling book about her time in the royal house called The Final Curtsy, a royal memoir by the Queen's cousin. And then while I was looking for images of Tahu Rhodes, I kept stumbling across images of this guy. So I had to work out who he was and how he fitted into the family tree, Teddy Tahu Rhodes. He is grandson of the World War I Tahu Rhodes, but he's not a son of Dennis. He's from another of the children. So he's the son of Terence Tahu Grosvenor Rhodes. You see that name Grosvenor is always in there. Tahu Grosvenor Rhodes, always. And so that made him a nephew of Denis and Margaret Rhodes of the English nobility. And his claim to fame is he's a bass baritone and opera singer. These photos here came from, I think, Opera Australia's website. And he has quite a number of CDs out there. And since I was trying out getting some audio, I found this short little clip of Tahu Rhodes. So let's see what his music's like, shall we? I'm sure if you like that, you could find more elsewhere. And well, this was almost an hour and a half, so time to wrap it up. So I'm going to say good evening. That's all I've got for you for this episode.